Our next speaker is Professor Eldar Shafir from Princeton University. He is mainly interested in decision-making, especially in the context of behavioral economics. Welcome to Uppsala.
It's a real pleasure. I've already learned a lot from my esteemed colleagues. I'm coming at this very much from a behavioral perspective. The slides are not perfect, but they'll do. As we've learned already, there is obviously a lot of issues that transcend the behavior of individual actors and doctors, but I will focus mostly on individual actors, and we can talk more in general after that. Several behavioral issues arise, both psychological in terms of people's own psychology and perception, as well as logistical, that are relevant to behaviors. Obviously, the diffusion of responsibility, the sense that the chance that I will cause the next single patient to have a problem is minimal as opposed to the collective. We know a lot about memory, a selective recall of salient and successful cases, which encourage additional administration of successful antibiotics and drugs. There are interesting time delays in the context of functioning of, say, a hospital context, where it's easy to prescribe an antibiotic and much less likely to come back and adjust it after the blood cultures arrive. And paradoxically, the fact that pharmacology today is so affordable and safe is going to lead to basically overutilization. So those are some of the issues. I wanted to give you a framework and think about two major themes that anybody who thinks about behavioral and behavior change should think about. So even if we keep knowledge and beliefs and desires constant, two very important things happen. One is construal. It's a profoundly trivial fact, but it's easy not to think about. When people choose between options or when they act on things, they're not choosing between things as they are in the world. They're choosing between things as they're represented in our three-pound machine behind the eyes and between the ears. In a sense, it's obvious, but it has enormous implications because what I act on is not one-to-one with what's out there. It's heavily influenceable by messaging, by framing, and I'll touch on that. So that's one thing. Construal is very important to think about. And second is the context, and people have touched on nudging. We know that very minor nuances in context can lead to big differences in behavior. What are the defaults? What are the obstacles? What are the perceived norms? And again, those are nuances that give policymakers and health professionals a lot to work with if we think about it carefully. So what do I mean? Let's talk about construal for a moment. If you get a reasonably good picture of this, you will not believe me that on the screen right now in 2D, the three cars are identical size. Now, you can actually take a ruler and test if you'd like. But the point is, there is something you're experiencing in your head that's not true in the world. In the world, these three are identical on the screen, and in your head, they're not. And that's obvious, and it's just one very simple, clear visual illustration of the fact that what we interpret, what we see, what we act towards is always an interpretation, a construal of what's out there in ways that are quite subtle and could be influenced. In this case, you know, 2D, 3D cues in the picture lead us to construe something that's different from what's there. Similarly, contextual nuance. So we know that basically competition between restaurants has led to bigger, this is American data, but it's pretty universal. So American restaurants now serve plates that are significantly larger than they were 50 years ago. Don't forget, when you talk about food, it's pi r squared. You get a lot more food in one than the other. And mindless eaters who just go around sitting down with a friend for a meal, we obviously don't go in planning to eat exactly 800 grams. We go in and finish our plates. And so what happens is that literally when you go into a U.S. diner today and order a hamburger, you're eating three of your grandmother's hamburgers when she ate in the same place 50 years ago. Now, this is a classic case of just contextual effects that kind of the mindless person acts towards. Again, notice these are people who might want to eat less. They might want to diet. They have clear beliefs about everything else. But keeping everything constant, just putting bigger plates will influence enormously what people eat. And this effect of context, the effect that small contextual nuance can influence how we act, has enormous implications, for example, for what we call the tension between intention and action. I love this picture. It kind of captures everything we need to know. But basically, you know, people have a plan, you arrange a world in a certain way, and they either act according to it or not. And again, we haven't touched their intention. These are people who intend to do the right thing, but small contextual nuance can lead them in the right direction or in a less good direction. And that's something that, you know, sometimes is due to chance, but very often can be influenced, construed, built by policymakers and others who want to influence what we do. Now, because context plays such a key role, there's a really interesting tension. And there's some really nice work on this. If you try to educate me, if you try to convince me, if you try to tell me how important it is to diet, to exercise, to be careful with administrating antibiotics or anything else, what you find is that it really has an impact on my prediction of what I will do. If you convince me that eating healthy is important, I now genuinely believe I'll make a bigger effort to eat healthy. But if you haven't changed the context, if it's still hard for me to come by healthy food, if the gym is still too far away, although you will have changed my prediction, I will continue acting largely as I did before. As in contrast, if you simply change the context in which I function, if you make in the cafeteria the healthy food more easily available, or the gym easier to reach, then what you get is, although I haven't changed my predictions, all of a sudden the intentions I had are easier to implement, and you get actually increased welfare. So what this says, in many cases, it's the context that you need to shape, not the education, not the convincing, not the changing of intention, to the extent that people already get it and have some of it, have some intention already to do the right things if they can. A very remarkable example of this I can give you here. FAFSA is the single most generous benefits program that the US government gives its citizens, at least until last week. And this is a financial aid to go to college. It's by far the most generous thing we give young people in America. It has, needless to say, enormous implications for your lifetime income and many other things. Going to college is an extremely important act in today's world. And yet, although this is an extremely generous program, there is an uptake of about 30% of eligibles. In other words, only 30% of young Americans are eligible to get $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 from the government to go to college, actually take it. Now, there's a real question. Is it that they don't know about this, or do they not want to go to college? What do we learn from this? So you do a study where you go to people and say, we've checked everything about your household income, about your parents' income, your income. We know everything about you. You're entitled to $30,000 of FAFSA to go to college. Here's the form. And what you see, that's the the green condition, nothing changes. So after you've told them that they're eligible and about the program, there's no change. Next condition, you go to them and say, you're eligible, we know everything about you, you're eligible to FAFSA, here is a form, and here is a nice person who will sit with you and help you fill out this form. And actual matriculation to college increases by 30%. So here we know people have the intention, they have the understanding, they want to go to college, and a stupid form is what stops them from changing their lives. This is important because when we train policymakers to think about costs and benefits, and education and all the rest, it never figures that a form and somebody who helps me fill it out will change so much. And so this is something to think about in a behavioral world, minor obstacles. Of course, these people didn't say, oh, the form is long, I won't go to college. They said, oh, the form is long, I'll put it on the shelf, I'll wait for when my sister comes back from medical school and helps me fill it out. And life goes on. And so it's a real art, in a sense, to understand where is it that people have the right intention, their behavior doesn't conform, and what to do to shift it in ways that allows them to thrive. And one of the major issues, by the way, is simply attentional. In the world of health, no doubt doctors and others are extremely busy and inattentive and distracted. And attention, for example, can make a very big difference to behavior. This is an amusing study where you basically send people messages in their hotel room trying to convince them to rehang the towels and reuse them again rather than have them washed. And so in the first message, you simply tell people, you know, environmental issues, it's important, please reuse your towel. and you get about 37% reuse. In the next one, everything is kept identical. Now I tell you what percentage of people in your hotel room have reused their towel, in your hotel have reused the towel, and you see an increased reuse of towels. And in the third case, just to really get your attention, I tell you 75% of people in your room, room 321, have used their towel, and towel use goes way up. Now, nobody thinks there's actually a camera spying on them, but to get your attention, to say, oh my God, they're really looking at this. Seriously, I haven't changed anything else. I haven't changed your intention, your understanding, but getting you to pay attention more changes how you act. And there is a very complicated and interesting logic here of psychological versus economic taxes and subsidies. There are very nice examples where you impose an economic tax on an undesired behavior. Instead of going down, it goes up. A classic example you may have seen before is done in daycare centers where parents show up late to pick up their kids. And so you impose a fine on showing up late, and latenesses go way up. And the explanation is, before, when I came up late, I felt guilty. And that's a psychological tax. Now, by making me pay 10 shekels, I don't feel guilty anymore. You remove the psychological tax, I'm happy to pay $10. And so what you've done is, by imposing an economic tax, you remove the psychological tax, and you've increased the behavior you try to avoid. And similarly, the opposite, you can introduce an economic subsidy and remove a psychological one and diminish behavior. So a classic example is a blood donation. If you have people donating blood because they want to be good citizens, and then you reward them $5, you've taken away the good citizenship. It's not worth $5 of my time, and you can actually diminish blood donations. This, by the way, is a reasonably legitimate concern right now about paying flight offsets for carbon emissions. There is a sense in which we worry that if, unless of course it's very, very high, if by paying $30, I feel like I've done the right thing, I might fly more rather than less. And so these are the kinds of things one wants to think about. And you can use these norms by making them sell it and get people's attention to influence behavior. A very nice study was done on energy conservation, where, as you can see here, people get basically their bill. And what you see here is their energy consumption compared to others. And the finding, and you know, you can be, in this case, the user is doing very poorly. In this case, the user is doing fairly well relative to others. It gets a little smiley face. This has been done in various ways, but basically what you find is that when I show you how you're doing relative to your neighbors, those who are doing poorly start doing better. And by simply giving you a salient comparison to a norm that's relevant to you, namely houses just like you in the neighborhood, you can actually have a serious impact on people's usage. Again, having done nothing, not educated them, not done anything else other than had given this sort of motivating comparison. And this was done actually in a medical context as well, where basically a fully randomized experiment, some doctors by random assignment had to give an accountable justification. So they had to quickly write down a very brief explanation for why they're deciding to administer the antibiotic in this case. As well, another intervention was to compare them to top performers. This is how much you're given, this is how much others are given, very similar to the energy use. And what you find is, this is just a copy from the paper, among these primary care physicians, the use of accountable justification in comparison to others had a significant result on lowering the rates of antibiotic prescribing. A couple last issues that have to do with how we construe the situation. There's a very clear sense in which we construe problems differently when we think about one case versus many. And so these studies, you basically ask physicians about a college student who has a problem, and would you propose to administer a somewhat exotic blood test for some unusual disease? Or the exact same question is posed not about one student, but about many. And what you get very clearly is that considerations of cost, of efficiency, of policy level concerns loom much larger when the physicians consider a group of students as opposed to a single one. And this, by the way, notice is a built-in tension. Physicians always treat a patient at a time, whereas policymakers and health professionals think about groups. And what this data suggests is that all of us think differently about one versus many. And then the question is how to introduce the perspective, the frame that captures the considerations implied by many, although you're treating one at a time. And so these are the kinds of nuances you want to play with when you frame these problems. One other thing I'll mention: we are all of us on this meeting are all about, you know, clear data and science and presenting things correctly. But there is a profound tension and a profound paradox, which is data and statistics, although laudable and terrific, are not terribly memorable and fade away. They're not very emotional. And this is a real issue because all the data suggests that to really get an effect, you have to be pretty condescending, treat people like children and give them basically scary messages. And of course, that's a real tension between those of us who want to be responsible and how to have a real impact. So I'll just give you one example. If you want to alert people to the gravity of domestic violence, here is one way. This is basically a fact about American life. In this American life, about 1,100 women are murdered by their intimate partner a year. We know that when I show you this, it's horrific, it's alarming, and tomorrow you'll forget what the numbers were. This, on the other hand, you will never forget again. And then the question is, how do we juggle sort of condescending, manipulative messaging that actually leaves you with a profound and hurtful memory, as opposed to data that comes and goes, and in this very busy life has relatively little impact? So these are just some observations generally suggesting that even if you keep knowledge, intentions, beliefs constant, simple considerations, minor tweaks of context, of construal, how people represent things, how they act in daily life, can have a significant effect on behavior and on performance. Thank you. I look forward to discussing.
Yeah. Thank you for extremely interesting